Premier.
Speaker, I rise to inform the House that today the Deputy Premier will answer questions for the portfolios of Climate Action, Energy and Resources and the State Electricity Commission.
I know. Come on, Hodgie. Are there any questions? Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Assistant Treasurer. On the 28th of July 2021, the Assistant Treasurer held up to $60,000 worth in Commonwealth Bank shares. However, his shareholding increased by up to $40,000 by 28 February 2022. Within that same period, on the 10th of August 2021, the Assistant Treasurer announced the Commonwealth Bank would be contracted to provide Victorian Government banking and financial services. On what date did the Assistant Treasurer increase his shareholding in the Commonwealth Bank?
Assistant Treasurer.
Thank you, Speaker. I thank the member for his question. As I've indicated, I've always acted appropriately. I've always declared my interests. And I refer the Leader of the Opposition to my previous answers.
Order. Member for Eildon is warned. On a supplementary question, the Leader of the Opposition. Order. On a supplementary question.
Thank you, Speaker.
Order.
Between the 28th of February 2022 and 28th of July 2022, the Assistant Treasurer reduced his shareholding in the Commonwealth Bank by up to $40,000. The Assistant Treasurer claims that he is not an active trader of shares, yet he traded Commonwealth Bank shares at the same time that he announced and held direct ministerial responsibility for and admitted being briefed and noting inside information about the Victorian Government's decision to contract the Commonwealth Bank to provide banking and financial services. Can the Assistant Treasurer please explain to
Order. Premier, I ask you to come to order so I can
listen
hear
the
supplementary question.
From the top, Speaker. From the top.
I'd ask you to continue your question.
Continue questions. Well,
order.
Well, sort of mid-paragraph.
Order.
The
order.
Assistant Treasurer claims that he is...
I'd like to hear the supplementary question, members. Continue.
The Assistant Treasurer claims that he is not an active trader of shares, yet he traded Commonwealth Bank shares at the same time that he announced and held direct ministerial responsibility for and admitted being briefed and noting inside information about the Victorian Government's decision to contract the Commonwealth Bank to provide banking and financial services. Can the Assistant Treasurer please explain to Victorians how this share trading for personal benefit is not a blatant breach of his responsibilities as a minister?
Member for Eltham is warned. Assistant Treasurer.
Oh, thank you, Speaker. And again, I have always acted and behaved appropriately. I've always declared my interests and I refer the Leader of the Opposition to my previous answer.
Members, I want to hear the questions, the supplementary questions, and I think it's appropriate to hear the answers. The Minister for Tourism, Sport and Major Events.
Thank you, Speaker. It is clear that for the Andrews Labor Government, equality is not negotiable. But what you get to see through my portfolios is that it is also celebrated, that it builds communities, that it tells wonderful stories, that it opens doors for entertainment and employment, and that it delivers not just a social benefit, but an economic one. An opportunity often lost on those opposite. Where some might see something to fear, someone who doesn't belong, we just see Victorians. Just another group of Victorians, we are here to serve, support and celebrate. Across tourism, major events, sport and creative industries, we take the opportunity to grow these sectors by being inclusive, giving all Victorians a chance to participate openly. We know that Victoria is a home of sport, of course, but we also know that many people from the LGBTIQ plus communities face unique barriers to participation in sport and active recreation. That's why we're proud to support things like the A-League Pride Cup match coming up on Sunday at Amy Park. We're also proud of the NBL's commitment to a Pride Round. And we're also proud of the Australian Open's Glam Slam, the world's biggest amateur queer tennis tournament that we also supported. Women, Speaker, have led the way in equality, inclusion and diversity in sport. We've invested over $100 million upgrading AFLW facilities. And as the investment has grown, we have seen participation grow, with female club registrations growing 43-fold in 12 years. This year's Midsummer program boosted the cultural output of the city, showcasing the talent of tens of thousands of artists with over 200 events in 120 venues. We recognise the significance of the time and place we live in, that with the right leadership, you can free a lot of people from a lot of anguish with just a little bit of respect. You might wonder in what time and place those opposite live. Only when their desire to govern is greater than their fear of some Victorians will they realise that equality is not a threat, but a wonderful opportunity. Yeah. We realised that a long time ago, it's who we are. Yeah. Yeah.
Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister for Consumer Affairs. Minister, today you stated, quote, "My wife resigned her position as the Deputy Chair of the Motor Car Traders Claims Committee, and on the 5th of December, general orders were updated, so the Business Licensing Authority was moved through to the Minister for Small Business, and that's entirely appropriate," close quote. "To eliminate perceived conflicts of interest, your family member resigned from one role, but you transferred the responsibility for her other role to a different minister. How can the minister justify the two different actions?"
On a point of order, Premier.
Point of order, Speaker. The Leader of the Opposition this week has had quite some difficulty in framing his questions in accordance with the standing orders. Ministers do not transfer. The general order is done by the Premier, the Leader of the Government. So the question does not relate to the ministerial responsibilities of the Minister for Consumer Affairs. And the Leader of the Opposition ought not be given his 15th opportunity to rephrase. The question should simply, with respect, Speaker, be ruled out.
Order. Leader of the Opposition will come to order. Order. Manager of Opposition Business on the point of order.
Speaker, with respect, the Premier will have lots of opportunities to debate any issue that he wants in this place. On the point of order, the question asked about a quote directly from the Minister, a quote that he made, well, comments he made this morning about his behaviour and his actions as Minister. It is entirely within standing orders to ask about his own comments today.
Order. The Minister for Consumer Affairs can respond to the question, and if he needs to, can refer it to the person who made the decision. The Minister for Consumer Affairs.
Thank you, Speaker. So questions in relation to the general orders should be directed to the Premier of Victoria.
On a supplementary question, the Leader of the Opposition.
You signed it.
Leader of the Opposition on a supplementary question.
Thanks, Speaker. Minister, isn't it a fact that these two different approaches were implemented to solve the same conflict of interest issue, namely because one was a better paying board position?
Minister for Consumer Affairs.
Speaker, I've acted appropriately at all times. I declared the potential conflict of interest. on becoming the Minister for Consumer Affairs. The declaration resulted in updates to the general orders, and I further notified the Cabinet Secretary, the Secretaries of the Department of Premier and Cabinet, the Department of Treasury and Finance and the Department of Government Services of those updates, and in order to ensure that all necessary arrangements were put in place by the relevant departments. And these arrangements, Speaker, they were entirely appropriate and they were specifically established to ensure that no conflict of interest arose.
On a Minister's statement, I call the Minister for Health.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I rise to update the House on the Andrews Labor Government's commitment to the health and well-being of Victorians, LGBTIQ plus Victorians. We know that LGBTIQ plus Victorians face higher levels of discrimination, stigma and exclusion than other Victorians, which leads to poorer health outcomes. This is simply not acceptable. And as all Victorians know, under the Andrews Labor government, equality is not negotiable. When it comes to equality, leadership matters.
It does.
Words matter. Doing what you say you're going to do matters. We are tackling the social and structural challenges that are faced by LGBTIQ plus community. And we are doing that through Victoria's first whole of government strategy, Pride in Our Future. Through the strategy, we'll deliver greater access to inclusive healthcare services that meet the specific needs of community members while respecting their identities and valuing our LGBTIQ plus communities for as they are and who they are. The real-life benefits of working alongside the community have been recently demonstrated in the response to the Mpox outbreak. We worked with Thorn Harbour and other LGBTIQ plus communities on a campaign that ensured that vaccines got as quickly as possible to those who needed the most in the simplest way possible for them. And this proved highly effective, and I'm pleased to say that as of today, there are no Mpox cases in Victoria. Now, this was a scarce vaccine, but we worked with the community, a community, the LGBTIQ plus community of Victoria, who our government always respects, always has, and always will.
The Leader of the Opposition.
Thanks, Speaker. My question is to the Minister for Consumer Affairs. Was the Business Licensing Board shifted out of the Consumer Affairs portfolio solely so that a member of the Minister's immediate family could save their job as chair?
Minister for Consumer Affairs.
Thank you, Speaker. I've already answered this question. I refer the Leader of the Opposition to my previous answer.
Order. Order. Leader of the Opposition on a supplement.
Thank you, Speaker. Take that as a yes. The Chair of the Business Licensing Board is paid up to $53,254 a year. Was the financial benefit of this role to the Minister's family income a factor in the decision to shift responsibility of this board for the first time ever?
Thank you, Speaker. Well, if the Leader of the Opposition had any courage at all, he would ask a question of the General Orders to the Premier. Right. I refer the Leader of the Opposition to my previous answer.
On a Minister's order, on a Minister's statement, I call the Minister for Education.
Speaker, I rise to update the House on the supports that we have in place for the LGBTI students, teachers and support staff across our school system. I'm so proud to continue to provide under the safe school programs the following provisions: professional learning for school staff,
order,
improved inclusion for school policies and practices, consultation, advice, resources and connections to local support services for any individual students that display signs that they need that extra support. And I've heard firsthand from schools just how vital the Safe Schools program is. And I was actually at my old college, Buckley Park Secondary College, with the member for Nidri, doing a bit of a tour around, and I've got to say, the pride in that place when it comes to safe schools. The posters that those kids had up and the engagement and the acceptance was just amazing. And our rollout of $200 million to the Mental Health Fund continues to roll out this year in 2023 to make sure that kids feel safe. And the organisation Minus 18 Plus has been included to deliver the workshops to promote positive mental health and improve the lives of our young people. This government also continues to embed the promotion of respect, positive attitudes and reinforcement, resilience and confidence through respectful relationships. I'm happy to say that almost 2,000 schools have signed up to this program across the state system, Catholic system and independent system, and it's a wonderful initiative that I hear positive things from both teachers and students. Unlike those opposite, we don't tolerate bigotry or hatred, and the safety and well-being of our children and young people is not a political game.
Order, 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 order. Member for Eureka can leave the Member for Eureka can leave the chamber for 1 hour. Leader of the Opposition on a point of order.
On a point of order, Speaker, the Minister knows better than to attack the Opposition in her ministerial statement.
I ask the Minister to come back to her ministerial statement.
Every child deserves to be respected. Every young person deserve to be respected and safe in our school system.
Yeah. Member for Richmond.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Right now, in the middle of a housing crisis, over 60,000 homes across Victoria are sitting empty for most of the week because property investors are able to make sometimes double the amount of rent from leasing their properties through unregulated short-stay platforms like Airbnb. Meanwhile, renters in regional towns and the inner city are facing record low vacancy rates and skyrocketing rents. As more and more families, retired women, young people, essential workers become desperate for a home, will the government make thousands of existing homes available right now for those people struggling to find a place to live by introducing urgent short-stay regulations to cap the number of days that a property can be listed for a short stay?
Premier.
I thank the Honourable Member for Richmond for her question. And whilst I have no announcements to make today in relation to residential tenancies matters, I will point out to the Honourable Member that the government is embarked on the nation's biggest ever investment in affordable housing. That's a point of pride for us, and I'll take the opportunity that the Honourable Member affords me to thank every single worker who's out there as we speak, building thousands of homes for vulnerable Victorians, giving them the security, the safety, the platform to build a better life, and to be safe, and to be certain, and to be secure. So that's the first point. The Honourable Member, on the issue of the big housing bill, I would, I know question time is not an opportunity for me to ask the Honourable Member a question, but I would ask a favour. Please get on to some of those Green political party councillors and ask them, and if the Member for Richmond's not happy to ask on her own behalf, just say, I asked you to ask them. Stop blocking public and community housing. Stop voting against affordable housing for victim survivors of family violence, for First Nations Victorians, for mentally ill Victorians, and for many others who simply want an opportunity to live in local communities that have, for this purpose, the misfortune of being governed by members of the Green political party. You can't, Speaker, be from a show.
Order. Assistant Treasurer will come to order. Member for Paran. Member for Paran can leave the chamber for 1 hour. Order. When I'm on my feet, the House will come to order. Premier.
The Member for Richmond, if she could pass that along,
to all of those Green councillors who steadfastly, consistently, shamefully vote against, frustrate and in some instances have prevented the building of affordable housing to deal with exactly the cohort Order. That the member pretends to Order. Care about.
Order. Order on a point of order, Member for Brunswick.
On relevance, Speaker, the Premier has blundered off the field and needs to be led back onto the topic of the question.
Order on the point of order, Leader of the House.
Speaker, on the point of order, the question went to the availability of low-cost and affordable housing, and the Premier is being entirely relevant to the question and simply pointing out that some more of that housing may well have been available if it were not for the opposition of the Greens political party.
The question related to affordable housing and the availability of it. The Premier was being relevant to the question.
Thank you very much, Speaker, for that guidance. I will again make the point. If you want to come into this place, of all places, yes. and ask questions about affordable housing, yes. then you need make to get sure out there and make sure that your comrades, your colleagues, those that are in your political party, are actually, and that yes. perhaps that you actually come from a political party that is interested in yes. affordable housing. Yes. Just get out of the way. Get out of the way.
Order. On the order.
Order. Member for Melbourne on a point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. On a further point of order, the Premier's been in this place long enough to know that question time isn't a time to attack members of other parties in this place.
I ask the Premier to come back to the question.
I've not been here nearly long enough, I reckon. But the member for Richmond also asked me about short stay issues. And I just, with the greatest of respect, she also talks about a number of buildings, a number of homes, a number of facilities that lie empty throughout the week. Now, this question would perhaps have more credibility if the member for Richmond's elected office was open 5 days a week. If she wasn't running her own little short stay long weekend every single week, this question might have much more credibility.
On a supplementary question, the member for Richmond.
I thank the Premier for detailing the buildings that this government plans to build, but right now 110,000 Victorian households are experiencing rental stress and the crisis is set to get worse. Just yesterday, economists predicted that rents will rise by another 11.5% this year. That's on the 10% that they rose last year, the sharpest annual increase on record. Rental vacancies are at an all-time low of 1%. I hear from renters that are lined up for two blocks to inspect a property. People going to five inspections a day. Desperate people
order,
tell me order. They're offering...
Member for Wenderee can leave the chamber for 1 hour. The member for Eltham can leave the chamber for 1 hour. Member for Richmond, continue.
Desperate people offering a year's worth of rent up front to secure a substandard property. Berlin, Dublin, Tokyo, New York have all introduced short stay regulations as part of the solution. New South Wales has regulations. Councils in Victoria. Will the Premier...
Members' time expired. There is no supplementary question. On a Minister's statement, I call the Minister for Mental Health.
I was only just starting.
Thank you, Speaker. Today I rise to update the House on the Andrews Labor Government's commitment to improving the mental health and wellbeing of people from LGBTIQ+ communities. We know that LGBTIQ+ Victorians experience significantly higher rates of mental ill health, and much of that, Speaker, is preventable. By promoting equality and providing safe and responsive mental health supports and services, we can ensure
Order.
All Victorians enjoy the good mental health and wellbeing they deserve. That's why our government has invested more than 60 $62 million to deliver a range of initiatives for our LGBTIQ plus communities, including $3.2 million to deliver a trial of safe spaces for youth in the Barwon region, $1 million to build the capacity and skills of leaders and organisations through the LGBTIQ plus grants program, $7 million to continue and expand Switchboard's Rainbow Door program to provide support in navigating and accessing the mental health and wellbeing system, $1.9 million to continue the Healthy Equal Youth Project's critical support for young LGBTIQ plus Victorians, $21.3 million to provide mental health support, primary medical care and peer supports for trans and gender diverse young people, $4.5 million to deliver a diverse community's mental health and wellbeing framework and a blueprint for action, and $9.6 million for the new Diverse Communities Mental Health and Wellbeing Grants Program. Speaker, the Royal Commission called for a mental health and wellbeing system that will meet the needs of Victoria's diverse population both now and well into the future. And only Labor will make sure every Victorian is supported by a mental health system that is safe, that is responsive and that is inclusive in Victoria and indeed in our government, Speaker. For every member of our government, equality is not negotiable.
Yeah. Member for Evelyn is warned. Leader of the Opposition.
Next time. My question is to the Assistant Treasurer.
Order. Order. Order.
The Statement of Values
Order.
In Part 2 of the Members of Parliament Standards Act.
I'd like to hear the question from the Leader of the Opposition.
My question is to the Assistant Treasurer. The Statement of Values in Part 2 of the Members of Parliament Standards Act 1978 tells us that members should demonstrate the following values in carrying out their duties: serving the public interest, integrity, accountability and leadership. Has the Assistant Treasurer always displayed these values in managing his share portfolio and ensuring that his family arrangements don't breach the Ministerial Code of Conduct?
Assistant Treasurer. Oh, on a point, sorry, apologies. The House will come to order. Hang on, I haven't called you yet. Leader of the House on
Thank
a point
you, Speaker.
Of order.
Thank you, Speaker. I ask that you rule the question out of order. It was very clear that the question referred to the responsibilities of members as members of the Parliament and not ministers of members of the Executive. As members in this place well know, questions are to be directed to ministers of the Crown in relation to their portfolio responsibilities and not simply as members of Parliament.
Order. Member for Sunbury can leave the chamber for 1 hour. On the point of order, Manager of Opposition Business.
Speaker, with respect, the first part of the question directly linked to the second part of the question and the values contained within the Ministerial Code of Conduct. But that link was clear in the question, and I understand that those at the table may not have been listening, but that link was definitely well said, in the question.
Well, order. On the point of order, Premier.
Speaker, the Ministerial Code of Conduct, questions in relation to that matter will be directed to the Minister responsible for that Code of Conduct, and that is the Chair of the Cabinet, namely the Premier, me. Ask me the question, and perhaps draft it a bit more carefully. Draft it a bit more carefully. The question is out of order. It does not relate to the Minister's responsibilities. It relates to his obligations to the House, and that's not what question time is for.
On order, order, order. I'm going to rule, if that's okay. I would like to rule on the point of order. The Assistant Treasurer can answer the question. If it is not part of his ministerial responsibilities, he can advise the House of that. Assistant Treasurer.
Thank you, Speaker. I've behaved appropriately at all times in my ministerial duties.
Leader of the Opposition on a supplementary question.
Thank you, Speaker.
Leader of the House. Deputy Premier on the supplementary.
Thanks, Speaker. The Assistant Treasurer has broken the Ministerial Code of Conduct by personally profiting from government decisions. The Assistant Treasurer has actively held shares which made a profit through government decisions he has been involved in. Despite a hollow apology, the Assistant Treasurer will continue to own and profit from his shares. And now, the Assistant Treasurer has been exposed exploiting the administrative orders to profit his family. At every step, the Minister has failed to be upfront and honest with the Victorian people about his share dealings and family arrangements. Will the Minister finally show some integrity, do the right thing, and fully explain all his share dealings to the Victorian people?
Order! Order! Assistant Treasurer, order! Assistant, order! Assistant Treasurer.
Haven't done one all week. How are you getting into the building?
Thank you, Speaker. Well, I'll probably
stand it. Shooting in or something?
Thank you, Speaker. It probably sounded better this morning. It all comes down to the delivery. As I've said, I have always behaved appropriately.
Exactly. On a Minister's statement, I call the Premier.
Speaker, I rise to hopefully put beyond any doubt a number of matters in terms of the policies of this government and the law of our state. And I'm saddened to have to do this, but it is important to provide clarity when it comes to a number of very important matters. Firstly, when it comes to the termination of a pregnancy, it is the law of this state and the policy of this government that that is a matter between a woman and her doctor. Yes. That is settled. That is settled, despite
not
what
some.
Might be said
not
in other parts
some.
Of this building,
not
in
some.
Other parties, at other times. Moreover, adoption equality is settled law in this state,
yes.
Because of work that this Labor government has proudly done to rewrite the statute book to make sure that equality is not only not negotiable, but is there for everyone to see and works and lives and is practised in every way. Again, our support for the trans community is not negotiable and settled. We will not weaponise these issues to make challenging times and challenging experiences all the more difficult. We will not use the trans community as a political weapon, shamefully, as others continue to do in this precinct,
that's
in
right.
the other place, this week. We will support the trans community in any way that we possibly can, and that is fundamentally a recognition that the trans community are 15 times more likely to self-harm. If that is not motivation enough, well, it's our values that tell us to do this, and that's why we'll continue to do it. Just finally, Speaker, let me put beyond doubt this government's support for safe schools. Safe schools saves lives. Any bullying, no matter what the motivation, we want to make sure our teachers are properly equipped to be able to protect their students. And it is shameful to think that some elected to this parliament continue to trot out absolute lies and misinformation in relation to that program. I'm standing up to make these matters clear. One wonders when someone else might do the same.
Order. Time for questions has ended.